Hello, everybody. My name is Dave Laribee. This talk is Testing Strategy, New Model, Better Outcomes. Just requisite intro slide. 20 years deep, multi-platform guy. These days, I'm doing a lot of agile and technical coaching in DevOps and large enterprise. Right? So a lot of what you're going to see here, it comes from my early frustration in trying to communicate testing strategy, putting together a kind of a lucid survey of the testing models and presenting that to larger enterprises. So let's start with the definition, because words mean things. Model, noun, a system or thing used as an example to follow or imitate. So we're going to start, this is kind of a duplex talk. We're going to start the first part of the talk looking at some testing models that are some of you may know, some of them might be kind of fresh to you, but these models are either like represent inventory models, like physical type models, or logical models of how you should structure your test suites, or sometimes they're more mental models or attitudes towards testing, okay? And now this is not a complete list. This list of models simply supports the end of my talk in which we kind of put them together. You will find other models, and hopefully we'll have some Q&A time. Think about the models that you're aware of, and maybe we can trade. Okay, so the first model is, I like to call it debugger-driven development. DDD, obviously an overloaded term, but debugger-driven development is typified by the so-called cowboy coding paradigm. This is a over-reliance on debuggers, right? This is where you're not really doing any testing at all. So absence of testing as a kind of model, right? And hopefully this isn't your situation. Of course, it's possible to overtest, but this is wild under-testing, right? We're just kind of relying on tools to figure out why something happened after it happened. We don't have a lot of intent. Maybe the best thing we could hope for, this is a bit of a throw-in, but I used to work for version one. I was an internal product development coach for them for quite a few years. And so what you're seeing here is version one's bug lists. Anyone ever use version one, agile planning tool? Okay, so if you've used it for a while, you know, it gets better every year. But when I started, this is back in 2008, of course you're gonna see defects around front end stuff because users tend to be supporting these defects. And this is typical of debugger-driven development, right? Where you have JS, JavaScript, always a problem, right? Action, which is an internal concept. You have things like dialogue, lightbox, and these are the main kind of pain points. Now, how I created this, I simply took all, I exported all the text fields, plopped it into Wordle, produced a word cloud. And this is like one of the fancier techniques you can use to figure out where your pain is, where you're having real regressions, where you're having problems when you're using a debugger-driven development model as your testing strategy. So let's review. And by point of introduction, I'm using this rage face. Pretty sure Gusta is Spanish for like, pretty sure like. These are things I like about debugger-driven development or things other people you encounter may like. Remember, I'm a coach, so I'm having to sometimes bring a tribe together, bring a group together, kind of norm on what that testing strategy is. So things I like about debugger-driven development or other people may like. I love my debugger and static analysis tools. They're amazing. They're powerful, especially when you're learning an API or you're not quite sure about what you're doing, or you're into a new platform, or if you switch to Java from .NET or whatever, it can be handy to inspect your program, right? It can be handy to understand what's going on, especially, you know, if you're younger or early in your career. You may just not know a difference, right? When I started programming, I was programming C all alone in a dark room, you know, with a bunch of Jolt or Mountain Dew and kind of real pasty, like a little creature in a cave. And, you know, I didn't really know, I didn't have any access to community, I didn't know any better. I was, you know, I was a religious studies and psychology major, right? So I'm kind of figuring this out on my own. So testing was like, what's testing? That seems dumb, that seems like a waste of time, right? So I'm just kind of cruising through. And then, you know, this is kind of going away a little bit, but the maintenance team will handle it. And I think that's really, especially being in India, I'm sure you've kind of, most of you have felt that because, you know, offshoring really started as buying testing departments. It started as buying like shipping departments now over. And now the companies I see, you know, in the Fortune 500 that have a good story with collaborators in India, they have autonomous teams, right? Just owning their own services, owning their own products. So this is a little bit old school, but you know, you still may run into it. So this guy, this is anxiety-asaurus, like this, like, you know, I don't really, I kind of, it rubs me the wrong way. I don't feel right about it, either me or someone else. But you're going to hear FML, that's internet slang. I'm sure you can figure out what it means, but something in my life. This is getting complicated. So, you know, this debugger stuff was fine as I was learning Node.js with WebStorm, you know, learning the APIs to make this little microservice. But now that I've got Node on lock, I got no tests, you know, and this is a true story from, you know, a couple years ago. Like, so sometimes I'm better at giving advice than taking it, so I just need to keep giving it, hoping it will stick. The app was supposed to be small. It was a one-off, right? This is a little tiny ETL that just turned into now this big mission-critical application, right? That's a common thing where this model will bend or break. And did you know, so in terms of cowboy coding, it's just not very sustainable. Marlboro Man is this advertising icon from the United States who, you know, is always pictured with a cigarette, and you know, 5 out of 8 of them died of smoking related diseases. So it's not a sustainable thing. Okay. So the testing pyramid. This is like the blue chip model of, you know, every agile testing group or people doing some kind of testing. Pretty much this speaks in terms of inventory, right? Forget about the I for a second. Also just side note, the deck, this is a reference fest. There's so many references in this, and they're all linked to the original paper. So credit where credit's due. I won't bother calling out the names sometimes, but if you look there, that's who's kind of innovating on this. This is more of a curation than a creation. So up here we have kind of automated GUI tests, or what are they, like end-to-end tests, where you have a lot of dependencies, or you're flexing a whole system. You may even have an environment set up to support that testing. So you have a lot of things that could go wrong, right? If something fails, you really have to start an investigation to understand. So you just want a few tests, and like the kind of rule of thumb is 10%, right? 10% end-to-end. Or, you know, like the cool kids from Ruby, Python, and Node community will tell you 1% or none, right? Or unless you're a Ruby on Rails DHH fan, they will tell you no unit tests and do all automated, you know, end-to-end tests, right? So it's confusing. But in the middle, you start to end up with things like API tests. Just cut off the UI and see if the behavior of the API through something like SOAP UI or something works, right? Automated integration tests. These are kind of testing one little aspect of the integration. Does my integration with some kind of, well, let's say Google API, because we've all had problems with that on the hotel internet, does that work, right? Just kind of testing one aspect of integration. Maybe testing that a query that's written in some kind of object language gets shipped off and returns the right results from a database over an ORM. And then we end up with component tests, like just testing a black box, a large chunky black box in our system, maybe the domain model, something like that. But down here at the base of our pyramid, that's really giving the pyramid shape its strength, although it's kind of a triangle, not a pyramid, but whatever, is our unit tests. So a strong developer testing practice where developers are shipping tests with their code as part of their definition of done. Right? So this is great, but pyramids, you know, there are all kinds of pyramids. This, for example, is David Bowie's diet in the 1970s, which he was a vegetarian at that time, and milk, red peppers, drugs. Pyramids have some weaknesses. We'll go back to what's good. It's about inventory taxonomy. It starts to give us a vocabulary for what kinds of tests, who's doing those tests, like what are the types of tests, right? A basic taxonomy of testing. And it gives us a notion of inventory. It's going to cost a lot of money. End-to-end tests are costly and brittle, sometimes impossible. Netflix, talking to the chaos engineering group, I was talking to the chaos engineering group there, and they don't do any end-to-end tests. They can't. It's a distributed system. It's super complicated, right? So they have to kind of rely on more component tests and then chaos engineering, where they just shut down a whole data center, right? This is great. It explains past mistakes. I've definitely done the inverted triangle when I first discovered testing. You know, when I first discovered Cucumber, I'm like, yeah, this will solve all my problems. So I'll just do a bunch of end-to-end tests, and you know, you end up with this kind of weighted, you know, inverted pyramid, which we'll talk about in a second. Isolation yields more pointed feedback. So these unit tests, these isolated, fast, ideally fast isolated tests, will yield when something goes red there, you know exactly what went wrong. Whereas an end-to-end test is more of an investigation. And I like the idea that developers test too, that testing as a skill that is a whole team thing, a la extreme programming, is a very valuable thing to get a team kind of to achieve a high level of quality together. So things that kind of throw me off a little bit, what's 10% mean, 90% mean? Is it straight count of tests? Is it runtime? There's no inherent guidance in that model for that, right? How big a pyramid are we talking? So we could have a pyramid like a Great Pyramid of Giza, a giant friggin' pyramid that's an awesome, like, perfect ratio of tests covering a giant monolith code base that's so hard to understand and so hard to dig into. So, you know, this pyramid thing kind of flexes in the day and age of microservices and the kind of hexagonal architectures we're pursuing now. I'm a test automation person. What does this mean for you? If you come in, now this is more of a coaching note. If you come into a testing group with this, with all these models, you should be doing it this way. You should prescriptive approach. You might be kind of challenging people's personal identity and sense of worth, right? You may also even be challenging how they're incented or compensated or measured in their organization. You may be challenging their family's well-being financially, right? So this might not necessarily be the best model to lead in. It might be something that you want to introduce after establishing a little bit more rapport, right? And I like to think about these models and how they'll be received in groups, how that will affect my ability to influence that group or collaborate with that group, right? And where do all these unit tests come from? So a developer may have the same thing. It's like, oh, gee, I haven't been testing like that. So, you know, we're a little bit far off from that. So the corollary model is an anti-pattern. It's the testing cupcake anti-pattern. Some of you recognize Hello Kitty. So in this anti-pattern, we'll start with it. This is actually the ice cream cone anti-pattern. I have no idea why you would name an anti-pattern after such delicious treats, but I didn't name it, so it is what it is. Here you have a bunch of manual tests that's like, ship it to the testing department. QA will fix it. You know, they'll come back and they ship a bunch of bugs back, right? And down here, you come down, and so you have the inverted pyramid. You have a unit test. Maybe a couple developers went to a software craftsmanship conference, and they're really stoked and writing a few tests, but it's certainly not a cultural thing. It's not like a normal behavior, right, for the whole team, okay? So the cupcake comes into, now we introduce Conway's law into the testing ice cream cone. So Conway's law, I'll paraphrase, but is that the communication patterns or style of an organization will be reflected in the software systems it produces. It's paraphrasing it, but that's the notion that culture is influential on product, right? It's a law. So in this case, what you have is a very handoff-driven culture, right, where you have maybe a big time zone difference, or maybe what you have is just a very kind of siloed organization that wants to own, you know, you have the, you know, VP of quality and the VP of engineering and the whatever, and they kind of protect their boundaries, right, a fiefdom, right? So developers throw their code over the wall, maybe they're 2 weeks or sprint or iteration behind these automated testers writing Selenium scripts. There are 2 weeks, you know, a couple iterations behind, waiting for that code to firm up so they can write their automations. And then they signal to the manual testers, now let's do some kind of, let time to get in HP test center and pull out all those scripts and just start going through it line by line by line by line, right? You know, I think Dilbert's funny because it's true, right? And I, you know, it creates bad blood. You have, you know, this kind of apathy, or you have straight up antagonism between these departments, right? You don't have a lot of synergy. You don't have a lot of, like, I can't believe I just said synergy. You don't have a lot of cooperation, right? So again, Conway's law, when you have a very hierarchical organization, you end up with a test inventory that looks a little bit like this, okay? All right, so in review, testing cupcake anti-pattern, pretty sure Gusta. That explains some of the angst I feel. You know, when I encountered this, when I encountered these sweet sets of anti-pattern, it explained prior years of my life. You know, it kind of set things clear for me a little bit. Your organizational culture has a huge influence on your testing strategy and what that testing strategy is. If you don't have an explicit testing strategy, your culture will guide what strategy you end up with, right? And I like to show this with the testing pyramid model, because I think it's nice to always show the model and the anti-model together. It gives people a little bit more meat in terms of some consultant dude coming in saying, thou shalt do it this way, right? Saying, look, here's a spectrum. Where are we on the spectrum? Okay, things that kind of bug me about this, this describes us. This describes us, right? So changing this threatens my role, right? So this is, again, an impactful thing to show. If this describes, and you kind of couch this as a negative, how people are doing it, then, you know, you could change the way, dynamic of that engagement, right? And it might put people on edge a little bit. We have a major investment in test center. This is an actual quote. It's like, working for a giant, one of the biggest retailers in the world, and talking about their testing strategy and saying, well, let's explore the idea of what if HP Test Center wasn't around, how might we do some like exploratory testing stuff? And they said, no, we've paid too much for HP Test Center. So that's a reaction. It's an interesting reaction. It's sunk cost fallacy, right? Why do we keep ignoring these 500 cucumber test failures? That's a direct quote from yours truly. You know, this is the notion that when you have this cupcake and you have some kind of fundamental design change in the at a base layer, like a schema change or some kind of change in like a data layer or a domain model or something like that, core service, that change can ripple through and affect a bunch of end-to-end tests. So if you have a very heavy end-to-end test weighted test inventory, you know, you're going to run into what Gary Bernhardt calls the binary test suite anti-pattern, where all of a sudden half your tests are failing. And now you've got multiple investigations to open to understand what's root cause analysis of that. And what happens is typically if that automated build is in a pipeline, you're running these cucumber tests for confidence prior to release if you're trying to get to continuous delivery or continuous deployment, I'll tell you what I did is I took it out of the pipeline, right? Our team decided to take it out of the pipeline, and then it became some, you know, pair of developers' job to fix those tests. Again, sunk cost fallacy. Rather than just jettison them or really dig deep and understand. And we eventually got to the point, instead of version one, we eventually got to the point where we said, look, cucumber, we need to pull back on how many cucumber tests we're writing. We need not automate every single acceptance test. But it was a painful lesson learned. Okay. Agile testing quadrants. So now we're starting to get into like real agile testing, whatever that is. And in agile testing quadrants, what we have is along the, on the y-axis, we have business-facing tests and technology-facing tests. On the x-axis, we have tests that support the team versus tests that critique the product. And then in the corners, we have some guidance about tooling, right? So over here, we see this is the base of your pyramid, unit testing, component tests, fully automated, fast, isolated, off the shelf. You shouldn't have to build a lot. You should be able to source a lot from either open source community or your vendor of choice, right? Up here, we have more functional tests. We're kind of getting into the tip of the pyramid, right, where we have example story tests. These are kind of maybe Selenium, Cucumber, that kind of stuff, right? BDD. Up here we have manual tests where we're doing exploratory testing, maybe even, you know, test scripting if we have a, you know, kind of known path that we want to cut through. Usability testing, and you can tell this is old because there's alpha, beta, that's A/B testing, right? Which kind of an edge case in testing, but if you have enough traffic, sure. And then down here in quadrant four, we have a kind of testing for architectural qualities and are we achieving those qualities? Things like performance, availability, that security, you know, pen testing, that would fit in there. And these tests, these generally involve very kind of expensive or high maintenance in terms of rigging type tools, right? Yeah, these are things you want to source or buy. You don't want to necessarily build. So, if we compare to this pyramid, we have, you know, our handy pyramid here with our little taxonomy. Basically, along here, more or less, we have the business-facing tests versus in the technology-facing tests. So one critique on this, taken from Goyko Adzik, it's a good guy to follow if you're into testing. He kind of recast this quadrants and said, well, really, over here, what you are doing is checking for expected outputs versus supporting the team, and what you're doing over here is analyzing undefined, unknown, and unexpected phenomena versus critiquing the product, right? So that he's playing with the notion that these axes, 10 years later, maybe have changed a little bit. So over here, you have things like, you know, maybe like canary deployments, right, where you kind of deploy to a small group, right, and kind of test and see how that goes. That there's a new set of tests, right? I think the quadrants are nice. What I like about them is that I think the main innovation here is that tests have an audience. They're written for someone. Someone cares about the outcome of a test, right? I think that's something that's probably a lasting addition to our discipline, right? Maybe we shouldn't invent everything and or automate everything ourselves. So how many of you have written the Selenium testing framework? Or, you know, it's just like everywhere you go, someone's got their testing framework. Is it slightly better than the next person's, right? And, you know, manual testing isn't dead. So extreme automation is an option. It's certainly possible to over-automate. It's certainly possible to over-invest in automation. Things that kind of maybe bug me a little bit about this model, or you might run into issues with, is, you know, the notion that I don't get the support the team versus the critique product divide. This is Goiko's idea that maybe that's a little bit legacy. Maybe it's more about analysis and review versus straight up correctness and checking outputs, right? I think that the business technology divide is kind of limiting in some applications. Like, especially if you're doing something like a domain-driven design or you're doing some of the stream-based architectures, business and technology in certain domains, it's good just to marginalize technology as much as possible and try to fuse business with whatever technical aspect you're doing. So to see the terms modeled in the code and that kind of thing, right? And how do tests tell us if we're building something people will want or use? That quadrant is very limited. It's very much about right way. It's not very much about right thing, right? And so it's not using some of the innate testing innovations that have come around since like Lean Startup. It's not using some of the testing innovations like prototyping, you know, like idea testing, business testing. Okay? Gotta talk about test first and test-driven development. I initially pitched a workshop on test-driven development, and Naresh said, no one will come. People don't pay for test-driven development. So I said, I also do continuous deployment. he said, people will come. People are interested in that. So this is my sneaky way of making you listen to a little bit of TDD stuff. But red, green, intentionally left off refactor because a lot of people forget to refactor or don't refactor, or that's one of the things that kind of falls by the wayside. Two main schools from test-driven development. I think this is an interesting divide. Detroit School, which is kind of state-based verification. Of course, you know this from extreme programming. Kent Beck, the Chrysler C3 project, red-green refactor loop, write a failing test, get that test passing, have the discipline to apply refactoring that is actually changing the structure of the code without changing the behavior of the code, right? It's a lot easier with statically typed languages like Java, C#. Black box, you're driving out an implementation from a public API. So if you're not doing refactoring, it's very easy to end up with a series of small balls of mud, right? Heavy emphasis on refactoring. Refactoring is very disciplined, very, very important. And if you were at Doc Norton's talk, if you're following this, you are producing technical debt, not producing cruft, right? I think that's, I'll have to check with him, but that was my takeaway from that talk. So Martin Fowler calls this a classicist style of testing. London School TDD, so a few years later came London School, which is using mocks and stubs to drive out your design. And this is much more of a design tool. This is all about designing object interactions. It's kind of the pinnacle of OO design in my mind. The main book here is Growing Object-Oriented Software Guided by Tests by Nat Price and Steve Freeman. But here you're using tests as a design tool. Heavy use of mock objects. That is a mock object. If a certain call that you set up, it doesn't happen, the test will fail. So it's like a stub with an assert, right? And your tests tend to look a lot like your implementation code, right? And if you're not doing this test first, mock objects make zero sense. Because why would you write your code and then go write a test that had your code that you just wrote in the code? You know what I mean? It's a little redundant. So tests here are really an industrial byproduct of design. They're scaffolding, right? They are the bamboo around the infrastructure, right? They are the kind of the apparatus that just goes away once the building's complete, right? And Martin Fowler somewhat derisively calls this the mockist style of testing. So I'll give you a little kind of example of, I have to read this because it's a script and it's hard to remember, but let's say we're driving out a controller using mocks, London School. We may drive out the interface of an adapter. So we're starting with this controller and we're writing our tests there. So red means that's where the center of activity. We're writing tests, writing code, doing refactoring perhaps. And here what we're doing is kind of going through that red-green loop, and we discover some kind of adapter. Maybe our controller is going to talk to some kind of logging service and log that this happened, maybe a security service, some cross-cutting concern. So we drive out an interface that we own, and we mock that interface, right? And we set up an expectation on that. Then we keep going. Maybe we discover an application service. So here what we're doing is London School TDD. We're discovering the interfaces that are going to collaborate with our controller, okay? And this tends to work really well for the kind of highly unstable parts of your system. Systems are objects that have lots and lots of dependencies, like controllers. And then at some point, you're going to hit a business object or entity. Maybe if you're in a financial, it's not a financial domain. It's not uncommon that you'll have, I'll use the classic bad example of the industry, you'll have an account, right? That account is probably some kind of stateful object that has state plus behavior, right? And here what you're doing is, here what you're doing is Detroit School. So when you drive into this, you will be kind of writing, you know, black box tests, and so you're kind of switching between the two. And at some point, you drive further in. If this is Greenfield, you start working the application service, test driving that out. And later, you come back and hook these adapters up to, you know, to the actual implementation. Or they exist already. And this tends to be, okay, this tends to be where there's like a lag between that and that. This tends to be where you have that black swan moment, that aha moment of, oh, my God, I just shipped a story. And there are 150 unit tests attached to that, whereas normally I ship the story and then maybe I write the tests in an amelioration sprint or a fix sprint or something like that later down the line. And that's what kind of tends to get people hooked on this approach. So you have to kind of run through it in one whole story, and the learning curve is pretty intense, okay? So this is why maybe people, like when managers hear TDD, they're like, no, maybe just better don't, right? Okay, so what I like about it, clearly a lot, right? But test first and to a lesser extent, test closely or in proximity. Ensure unit tests get written and not forgotten, put off. Doesn't mean your unit tests are any good, but at least they're getting written. And then we can start to talk about the quality. Design your code by treating everything as an API. Your tests are simply the first client. So, but through testing, you are kind of flexing the quality of your code and saying, is this expressive? Is this something I would understand 6 months down the line when I had to come back into it? Is this something I could, I'm not pinned to for the rest of my life? Scales with level of detail. So we talked about very code artifact level or very technical design TDD, but I think this same red-green refactor approach can be applied to business ideas. Certainly we see things like lean UX, lean startup, the lean family of processes employ test-driven at a higher level. And it's a nice tool, but you know what they say about silver bullets. So I think right next to me, Naresh is presenting about why he dropped TDD, you know? And I'm conscious of that. I wish we could just have a little door and he could, like, and I'll just come over there and I don't know what I'd do, but he could come tell us why. And I've kind of tracked that way. It's a tool I use now, but I'm also using things like collection pipeline programming, functional programming, and straight up diagramming, you know? My basic redneck UML still works pretty good to get a group going, right? Okay, so things that kind of throw me back a little bit on this run into problems with. Discipline's hard. I forget to refactor sometimes. So that notion of conscious discipline over time becomes unconscious habit. It's true, but it takes this particular practice will take you some time. So you need to have the venue to do it. You need to wake up early and do code katas if you're not allowed to do it at work, or you need to ask for forgiveness rather than permission, speaking to Doc's point. You need to find a way to do it, and it's going to take some time to kind of make it stick. And now that's one person. If you're on a team, even a two-pizza team, 8 to 9 people, it might take an outside influence. I do this, by the way. But anyway, so rugged, steep learning curve. Mock objects are weird. London School tests seem redundant. Like, you're just writing the implementation of the test. If you're not doing tests first, they seem redundant. Right? They're also kind of like the London School tests. They don't really do much for you in terms of verification or confidence. They're like I said, they're scaffolding. You can delete them, and it's hard to overcome that attachment and sunk cost fallacy sometimes, right? Practicing both Detroit and London state versus interaction-based verification blurs the line of unit. This is just a notion that when you get into this, not every class has its own test suite, not every function has its own test suite. It's that you could have graphs of functions that have one test suite, right? A little technical. So we'll talk about this. Pitbulls, I don't know if you have them out here in America, where I'm from, Atlanta, Georgia. The rappers all have pitbulls because it's like the tough thing to have, right? So like if you're tough and hardcore, you gotta have a pitbull. So that's what that image means. T-A-T-F-T will become clear in a minute. So let me ask you a question. When do you test? When the code's ready. I heard all the time. Okay. When the code, okay. Well, so this is a mental model for testing, and there used to be this whendoitest.com. I reckon whoever had this registered maybe had to go get a job somewhere or something. I don't know, but they took this off. Whatever. So this is the notion that it's a really intense approach to testing that you're going to just throw yourself in. And what you found this kind of happening with the JavaScript and the Ruby communities where it was like, test all the time, you know, let's test. And they kind of just followed the classic hype cycle, right? So the test, ever over-testing, basically. Testing everything. Rather than a gradual and intentional adoption of the practice, they just wrote 11 billion tests. This is something like you would see testing getters in, straight getters in Java or accessors, you know, in .NET, like, or testing behaviors of collections. Like that should, you know, you're taking that dependency because you assume someone got it right, you know? So you're testing things that maybe you shouldn't test, or you're over-testing. And so what happens is you have some kind of shift in your system and a bunch of tests break, and you run into this really sad disillusionment phase, right? Versus a pragmatic approach or like a gradual approach to testing. So yes, you might say, what could you possibly like about this? Whole team testing mindset, and I think tests infected, their classic paper, right? That's a great thing. It's a great thing for a team to adopt testing as an activity versus tester being a role or responsibility of one individual, right? Tester could be maybe the leader of that activity. I like this quote from Aldous Huxley, the secret of genius is to carry the spirit of the child into old age, which means never losing your enthusiasm. So just because I've had some lessons learned the hard way doesn't mean I'm going to necessarily rain on the enthusiasm parade. Enthusiasm is a great thing. It's really something we should, you know, cherish and nurture in teams, right? So if people want to test, let's get in there and pair with them, maybe, and that's a better way to influence. So things that kind of bug me a little bit is execution bias creating a team fixation. So what other things could we do to improve our product and our code quality? So maybe like hardcore developer unit testing isn't just the straight answer. Maybe there's other testing approaches that you could adopt. And I like this corollary quote, enthusiasm just creates bubbles. It doesn't keep them from popping. So enthusiasm is great, but it needs to kind of be paired with a little bit of, I think, prudence. Okay. So I think code coverage counts as a testing model. It certainly is interesting. I think people have different relationships to the metric. I kind of, if you went to Doc's talk, agree with pretty much everything he said about code coverage. Where I have a real problem is when it's used as a kind of a KPI for quality, right? It does not make sense to me. I think at best it's a spurious correlation, right? So just because we have a high correlation between per capita cheese consumption in the US and number of people died by getting tangled in their bed sheets doesn't mean that there's a causation, right? So high coverage doesn't necessarily lead to high quality. Now that said, I was pairing with, it is a .NET, I think Visual Studio, we were doing the bowling, 10-pin bowling kata, and we hit a point in test-driven, you know, very kind of evolutionary emergent design, very Detroit school test-driven development. But we hit a point where our design just became unsustainable, right? It became very cyclomatically complex. We had a number of ifs and counters tracking what frame you're on. And it's, you know, it's a simple game, but it's a good kata because it kind of gets to a little good level of complexity where test-driven works. And what we found is we had to kind of pivot and switch our implementation. So we decided to introduce the notion of a frame, and the frame would listen to the game, basically observer pattern, right? And so we tore down a test and we started, it's not a refactoring, it was a mini rewrite, okay? So code coverage was really handy in this case. You can't really see, but there's this notion of rolling machine, which is this abstraction that tracks the rolls, right? And there's this thing, this function on frame called isSpare that's partially covered 86%. So code coverage, tactically, very useful here to when you do like a mini rewrite to say, I need to go retrofit tests, right? Code coverage also, I think, well, very useful when you're introducing a testing practice, right? Because it's tempting to go back to code first versus test first, right? So coverage can help you keep you on the rails and say, oh, I could have done this maybe test first this way. What I don't like about it is the kind of various divides it creates. I don't like it as a yoke metric. I don't like it as a KPI. I don't like it as something that is used to, I think there are very few metrics. I can't think of a quantitative metric that gives you code quality, like at a systemic level. It's you're in a qualitative domain. Quality, right? Quality is qualitative. So I think that's gonna your outcome your code quality is going to be seen reflected in your release outcomes. It's going to be seen reflected in the conversations that you're having if you're a leader with your technical leads, your senior technical staff. It's going to be more of a kind of echo metric. It's not very satisfying, but it is what it is. So one other model we want to cover before we go into a synthesis of models, exploratory testing. Who's doing any kind of exploratory testing? A few, okay. Who's doing, who's working in teams that are doing highly scripted testing, like at HP Test Center? Okay, what's the alternative? All right, so exploratory testing, simultaneous learning, test design, test execution. James Bach is the inventor here. FedEx, delivery service. So James Whitaker created this notion of exploratory testing with a tour metaphor. So you take a different tour metaphor. So this FedEx tour metaphor, DHL tour, or whatever, is taking a package and tracking it all the way from origination to delivery. So where that package is data. So a customer enters an order, tracking that through your systems. And that's what you start with, that metaphor. And from there, you kind of go through and just do a little exploration to see how that scenario works. So you're starting with a very high-level thing rather than a scripted thing, and you're doing a more improvisational approach through the system, right? So that's really, in essence, what exploratory testing contrasted to the more scripted, which is prescriptive, follow this cut through the system, right? So FedEx Tour is one example. The other example we'll treat here, HugOps, right? But we have, we're not going there for a free hug, but the back alley tour, this is a notion where you're coming at a system with maybe not the best of intentions. So like pen testing, you're trying to break it. You're trying to say, what can I do? Can I SQL inject? Can I hack on this, right? And so the James Whitaker book is really good. He lays out it's a good reference book for tours, let's put it that way, and that it will give you a number of tours that you can do. There's a sales tour, money tour, like saying, trying to demo your software to someone that might buy it, right? But these become the basis for more freeform kind of explorations into your software. So what I like about exploratory testing, people support a world they help to create. It's very easy to bring someone into the mix and to conscript testers from your pool of engineers or pool of designers and give them like this basic vector into your system, right? All hands on deck approach. It's a sound alternative to maintaining expensive DB of manual test scripts, which often go stale. This is inventory, right? Lean tells us to reduce inventory. Inventory, carrying costs of inventory, right? Things that might kind of bug you or the people around you. Developers develop, testers test, staff are lawn, right? So kind of ownership. What about my test scripts? Again, this may be something that you are incented on or as part of your, you know, professional identity. And as a manager of testers, how do I know we haven't regressed? So there might be this kind of belief that these rigorous test scripts correlate to high quality, right? And that a more loosey-goosey, hippy-dippy approach will not yield the same amount of quality. So it could be a tough sell. Okay, so in remaining time, I'd like to pivot to strategy, and I'll show you an example of a strategy that combines these models. And this is where I'll often kind of begin educating a team or introducing a team. This strategy is built for a typical kind of web application. It's not too fancy, not a distributed system, not a microservices architecture, but your run-of-the-mill web application. So strategy, noun, a high-level plan to achieve one or more goals under conditions of uncertainty. And I like to call this kind of approach to strategy gestalt. Then gestalt is simply an organized whole that is perceived as more than the sum of its parts. It's a concept that comes from psychology and art. It's a notion that by using a few pieces, you can get a larger perception. In software testing, I kind of apply this to the idea of how can we get the maximum confidence for the minimum or effort, right? How do we leverage a few strategies wisely to get confidence in a tighter feedback loops? Okay, so you should recognize already there's some models in here. There's a bit of quadrant. There's obviously a pyramid. There is an eyeball. So let's take it step by step. At the top, rather than talking about end-to-end tests or API tests, let's talk about safety. These tests will give us confidence the software is working. They help us find regressions before our customers do, so prevent embarrassment or maybe loss of income, right? So safety is an acronym. Smoke tests, is it working? Did it ship? Is it in the data center? Is it serving? Is it available? Automated acceptance tests, maybe in the course of delivery you find some core acceptance tests that you want to automate. Feature tests, testing large important features. So we're getting the concept of harvest and yield. If we have a large system, are there features that are more important to be available than others? Exploratory testing, and this notion that exploratory testing is kind of the way that tests get born, right? It's the central nursery for tests. Like, we find a cool or interesting cut through the system that we want to automate. Our exploratory testing informs our automation effort, okay? Curation over collection. So curation is like in a museum, a curator will pick from their whole collection and they'll put on a show. And that pick, they choose objects or they choose works of art that go together, that tell some kind of longer form story. That's curation. Collection is just, let me just collect every piece, you know, that's important, right? So curation is all about saying, what are the tests that really promote our safety at this time? And it's an active process. It's not about writing and automating and just accumulating tests. It's about curating the tests that give us a sense of confidence. Written and understood by the team. So specifically understood by the team, this is the notion that a test failure should be meaningful to the whole team at this level. Right? These are kind of business facing from the quadrant realm. Time box. So part of this, an implicit test, is that all of these tests run in the amount of time given. So that will vary from system to system, but let's say you pick half an hour, it's a small application. These tests will need to run in half an hour, or if it goes 31 minutes, that you fail. And maybe that's in your CD, maybe that's a step in your CD pipeline. Maybe that's something that makes you do a rollback, right, depending on how sophisticated you are. But there's a time box here. Why do you think there'd be a time box? Because curation over collection. The time box forces you to curate. It forces you to make choices about what goes into your safety suite. And I'll have links, so if you didn't get a snap, then you can download this. So at the bottom, at the base, this is where we kind of had developer tests or unit tests, but I like to divide these into two, roughly along Detroit and London school styles. So here you have specs, examples, developer tests, or developers are writing these tests. Millisecond feedback, they're fast. High value feedback, right? They're pointed, they're isolated. They fail for one and one and only one reason, right? State-based verification, Detroit school. Black box, refactoring dependent, Detroit school, old school, and these are testing often small graphs of independent objects. We're not so worried about unit equals class. We're saying unit equals maybe an aggregation, a composition, you know, a small network of objects. So we'll come over to design and discovery tests. Also unit tests, also fast feedback. Heavy use of test doubles such as mocks and stubs to design object interactions because you're doing this kind of micro code generation where you generate the code as you go, right? It may not exist, you type it as you go, you have a lot of red, you generate it. Tools help you. Help us discover boundaries and layers, right? Help us say, well, there's something wanting to get out here. So by using our test as our first client, we kind of can feel that. White box, that is, our test implementation often looks a lot like the implementation of the code. That's okay. London school, the new old school. Deletion is okay. It's scaffolding. You tear it down when it's done. Or you just leave it there because it's fine. But you don't really get hung up on if these tests fail. It's very easy to make an interface change and have a bunch of tests, these type tests fail. Right? It's easy to make a contract change and a bunch fail. It's hard initially, if you don't know, to let those tests go and just delete them because you think they're tests. You know, you of course you want to keep your tests because look how many thousands of tests I have. Okay. And lastly, we'll go into the I. Here what we have is product level testing. This is kind of driven exploratory testing. Whole team testing, we hopefully have a testing culture, exploratory prompts automation. It's mindful of its own size, right? So the notion is that, mindful of its own size. So the notion is that the governance of this testing strategy is such that the size of your test suite is a leading indicator that you might be have an opportunity to introduce a partition. You might have an opportunity to introduce a boundary. You might have an opportunity to componentize your software, right? Adopt, you know, so the I is kind of also about, you know, evolving and, you know, deciding how that strategy kind of evolves with the software you're producing. Adopt, maybe you evolve passionate users, right, in the testing approach. Maybe you adopt session testing, so you get an all hands on deck before you do a larger release. And you kind of do an exploratory session testing toward before the release with the people that can actually fix the software. Adopt the testing shard or the canary release. This is kind of similarly to how Facebook at least used to treat Australia and that they would release all their new code to Australia. And if they heard any complaints from Australia, they would maybe roll back, but they don't apparently care too much about Australia's business. But I've heard, worked with a client that had a storage service, and what they would do is they had pivoted to a new model, more of a vertical storage service, and the photographers that they had in their previous, focus, they put on a shard, and they would just release the new software to that shard because they didn't care about them leaving. So it's kind of a negative. But you could also have a testing shard that was released to, I don't know, like Google Canary, Chrome Canary release, where I actually want the new features. So it's a positive negative thing. It doesn't always need to be like sneaky, evil Silicon Valley stuff, right? Contract testing, this is a notion, we don't really have time to get into this, but this is the notion that we might start testing our third-party dependencies. If you come to my workshop on Sunday, we'll deal a little bit with contract testing. And voila, we have a number of models in a testing strategy. This is a generic approach. This is something I bring to conferences. But the idea here is that what we're doing is we're kind of pulling in a number of approaches to formulate a strategy that is suitable for in our context, right? Testing, we talked a lot about testing. I'd submit to you really what we're doing in testing is, this is classic XP. I changed listening to observing. But there is a gestalt between a confluence of these core activities. When, for example, we're doing test-driven development, London School, how much testing are we actually doing? We call it testing, but really going through this loop, right? So at this point, I think I'm out of time. Am I? Okay. So this will be a rhetorical question. You can reach me in the hallway, and I'd love to hear about your testing models. Which models do you see in your strategy? Thank you very much. Appreciate it.